Welcome to the War Room, a weekly roundtable discussion that takes place every Sunday at 5 p.m. Eastern Time. Tune in at 911warroom.com/zoom.
Welcome, everybody. It's 5:02, February 20th, 2022. I have no internet access right now, so it's going on from my phone, and I wanted to start off with a video.
No sleep till...
I got three stories real quick. This is ridiculous, so bear with me. Life Care, newest ambulance dedicated in remembrance of 9/11. Basically, this was the first EMS team that was on site. I think six of their crews. One 9/11 Life Care crews were on one of the first EMS units on the scene. So they basically dedicated a new truck to 9/11. Pretty cool paint job. They got the Pentagon on there and such. This is an interesting story for us. Son of a fallen 9/11 firefighter making sure the next generation doesn't forget. He's in college athletics, and what this guy, Chris Canizzaro, lost his father, says here, now a senior baseball player in Bucknell University, he's one of the newest student athlete advocates for the Tunnels to Towers Foundation, which launched a new student athlete initiative in September aimed at utilizing college athletes to educate young people about 9/11. So I'm going to try to communicate with this guy and come off very softly with 9/11 Truth for Justice, because if they're going to educate young athletes in college at the college level, this is an opportunity, I think. So again, son of fallen 9/11 firefighter now making sure the next generation doesn't forget. And the last news item I have, former NYPD detective, 9/11 responder, loses 100 pounds after cancer and heart failure diagnosis. Hey, Kale. Basically, he's made a positive comeback from the cancers and just talks about him. His name is Frank Thomas of Brooklyn. New lease on life. Good one for Frank Thomas. Anyone else for new news items? I wasn't presenting. My screen was probably all tiny. No news items.
I'm just waiting for the media to start with the Ukraine situation, trying to relate it to 9/11. I don't know if anybody's picked up anything from that, but I the way they are beating the drums for war, it reminds me of all the disinformation. The children's school, like that bombed, is like the incubator story. I don't know if anybody's been following they've tried to throw 9/11 into the mix, but it'd be interesting to keep an eye on that.
Yep, I haven't heard anything yet.
I don't know, maybe Ed knows a thing or two. I think Ed is pretty well-versed, maybe not at the Adam Fitzgerald level, but for geopolitics, you have a lot of insight into things that we don't always.
With respect to Ukraine and Russia, not really. That's one area I haven't really delved into. I have a lot of friends who are actually from those areas, and they have their own perspective with respect to, from their point of view. For me, it's just par for the course, same old shit, same old, different day. It's just, okay, here we go again. If you put up a form and fill in the blanks, this is what you just kind of just rinse repeat, so that's how I look at it. Nothing surprises me anymore.
New enemy of the day. Are your friends in the Ukraine or in the USSR? Or
both, actually. I got tons of friends in both countries.
Okay.
Ukraine a lot, quite a few in Ukraine. And then he's worked with a couple, and then worked with friends from Russia as well. Worked with the Russian Army back in the day. Worked in communications and satellites stuff. Smart guy, really bright.
And do you feel that what you're getting from them is biased based on where they are, or are you?
No, they're now full blown American, so they're looking at it more from kind of like they understand the history, so, and they understand it very well. So they're looking at it from that point of view, but through their own microcosmic understanding.
Right.
But also having an American sort of broader viewpoint on it as well. So if that makes sense. But I don't have, but it's hard to being able to provide any information on that with related to 9/11 would be something I don't have any information on.
Okay.
Thank you anyway. Welcome Susan for joining. Let's see. Some of the things I wanted to show were visual. I'm gonna hope I get internet access again, so I'm not doing this over my phone. But
maybe start with the stuff that you don't need to share necessarily.
Well, let's see. Wanted to show the sticker updates. Sandra went up in Canada and put out some stickers. Deb Lee did one, and I've done some. Actually, I have an idea for us. If anybody's ever heard of geocaching, it's this craze where everyone goes around and they hide little things in the woods or a little hand hole somewhere.
Hold on a second. Deb?
Listen, I don't know how to fix it. I cannot find it in my setting or anything. And somebody tried
you must out. Have got... You must have got bit by a spider, and you got some special powers.
Spider woman, whatever. Yes, yes.
She thinks she's a bat.
I'll figure it out. Yeah, I've put up a few stickers now around New York City. You know, it's so eye-catching. 9/11.
Yeah, the Einstein one is eye-catching because of the red in it.
Yeah. It has QR code for engineers. So when I'm out of those, it's cold out there, you know, trying to get your fingers in there. But when I'm out of those, we can do one with that has the QR code for truth911.org. I think that'd be great.
Yeah.
But they work good. I made pretty small ones, and the QR code works just fine.
Perfect. So,
great.
Excellent. My internet is coming back. I'm joining right now, and I'm going to show Deb's picture and join the audio. Oops.
Goodbye. I'll take more pictures too when I get out there. You know, I don't put it up and take a picture. Like, I don't want to draw too much attention.
You're right. But that, you know what I discovered is when I know, like, the ideal thing is to put up the sticker as you're going one way, like say you're going towards a store. And then you take a picture on the way back.
Because
as you're going, you stick the picture and, you know, you can do it pretty quickly. So no one will really clue in. You know, if you stick the picture and then you start taking out your camera and you start taking, you know, pictures, then it's going to be a lot more obvious. But if you just come back and it's like, hey, look at what I just saw and I'm snapping the shot, then they can't really pin it on you. So.
Yeah, exactly.
I say I have to be very strategic about it when you don't have a lot of time.
Everyone seeing my screen?
That's Avenue C and East 3rd Street, New York City.
I love that this was freshly painted red. You can see the extra overspray on the bottom. And right. Deb didn't miss the opportunity to slap one right on.
Well, not only that, but it says FDNY right under it.
That's awesome.
Somebody already got the other side with some band stickers. You know, people don't wait a lot of time to put stickers up around here.
So this is one of the places Deb did. Sandra also, find it here.
Yeah, right there.
This is coming out of a bus garage, I believe.
Well, it's a bus shelter. No, it's a bus shelter where people wait for the bus.
Okay.
So there's like this glass bus shelter that people stand inside when it's like minus 20, right?
Yep.
So if they're looking that way, they don't have a choice. It's right in front of them. They're staring right at it.
And explain what this is to everybody.
And this, I mean, I just discovered that the city of Montreal actually makes these kinds of posts available for people to pin anything that they want for about a month. Like they clean them up once a month. But if you have a garage sale or something like that, you can put it up there. And there was nothing on it. So I just put my sticker right in the middle of it.
Nice. So on this idea, let's see if I think I had some in here too that I did. Oh, this is Kale's. We're going to come back to Kale. Oh, here were the other ones. Did we show these ones last time?
I
think you did.
I think so. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it didn't close.
We lose Jean again?
I don't know. Entirely possible. His electricity is in and out. Did you get your stickers yet, Al? Oh, no. Oh, those were the ones that you were showing.
Yeah, these here. I still have to put them up. I haven't gotten into Boston yet. I feel more comfortable plastering Boston than my hometown.
You know what? I mean, it's funny because I look at you and, you know, all you have to do is throw on a suit and tie and nobody is ever going to suspect someone like you doing guerrilla activism in the middle of Boston.
I think I'm back, right?
Yeah, now you're back, yeah.
I apologize if this keeps happening. I normally don't have internet problems. CIA's out there. FBI's out there hacking my internet connection. 515. So what geocaching is basically people set off these trinkets wherever and they put the GPS units on these apps and they go and like it's kind of stupid. It's just silly little hobby thing. Like, oh, look, here's a little nook in a tree that somebody hid something. You go and you find out what trinkets and you put it back and people just, they go and look at these caches. What I find interesting is I wanted to use it for stickers and it's kind of funny that on their app here, they show downtown.
Oh, boy.
Mm-hmm.
Must be the Russians.
Yeah. So many people to blame, so little time. He'll be back. I'm trying to understand what this, like how this sounds a little bit like the craze that we had with Pokemon.
Oh.
Like it's almost like it's based on that idea, except that there's real.
Yeah, find Pokemon. Yeah.
Yeah, you remember that craze like 3 years ago or something?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Insane.
Yeah, that was it came and went really quickly, but yeah, I mean, it's to use your phones to find hidden things. Sounds a little bit like the same principle.
Well, I feel like Richard Gage trying to run a show. Jeez, I'm I'm going to give up on that, I guess. I don't realize how long, I don't know how long I was talking before I was talking to myself.
Oh, you stopped at saying that you were showing the map of Pittsburgh and you found that there were several locations. It was like
downtown Manhattan.
Oh, it looked like Pittsburgh. It looked like
So basically, if people tag where they put the stickers on this map, it's free. We could all see as this grows. And if you ever go back and it's not there anymore, you just erase it. It'd be nice to keep track of the preponderance of stickers and like how well areas are already saturated with stickers and where we could work on other areas. And it'll start looking like a network across the map. I think it'd be interesting. I'm gonna start to do it around Pittsburgh, I think, as a little side thing. That was the stickers. The next thing I wanted to mention, if people can still hear me, So our federal grand jury right now, we're waiting to hear back from the Second Circuit Court of Appeals on the decision. And I now, after talking and listening to this so much, I understand exactly how to simplify this on what's being done. Mick is fighting for our First Amendment constitutional right to be able to present the evidence to a grand jury. That's all we want, just to present it to the grand jury. That's our First Amendment constitutional right. It's also the second part of this. It's the duty of the U.S. Attorney in the Southern District of New York to do that via the federal statute you hear about all the time, 18 U.S.C. 3332. So not only is it's our right for that information to be presented to the grand jury, it's also their duty. And what's happening is the Department of Justice is fighting back, saying, no, we don't have standing on a First Amendment that the grand jury needs to hear the information, which is what Mick's fighting back. We're not asking on whether they'll hear the information. We just want the information presented to them. And that's our First Amendment right. And we think that if the information is presented to them, they're going to do something. Because when you see the 60 exhibits, it's tremendous evidence for the controlled demolition of 1, 2, and 7. So I think it's exciting. Love it. That is the tip of the spear.
Gene, is the next step literally the Supreme Court, or let's say that LC gets shot down, you know, tomorrow or whatever? What is the next step?
So what Mick has made clear is that from all the legal talks and things from lawyers in the area and on the subject, this is coming from a bad decision on the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court needs to be corrected. And this would be the case that would allow that. Whoops, it's 5:20. Let me break for a prayer here, everyone. Lord, thank you so much for this time and what's going on in 9/11 Truth. I just ask that you would continue to bless the folks that are doing this, to help them to persevere, give them the wisdom to say things that need to be said to other people, for them to hear truth, and also help us to not say things that we shouldn't say that would discourage people from 9/11 Truth. I just ask that you would continue to protect Richard Gage and the lawyer committee on these important events that are happening so that we could truly get justice for all these crimes that have committed. In your name I pray. Amen. All right. Thank you. So there are a couple other things they can do before it would go to the Supreme Court. I forget what word he used. Fancy lawyer. New word I've never heard. They can do some things on this level, but basically the Second Circuit Court of Appeals is bound by prior litigation, which was done at the Supreme Court. And this is the opportunity for us to get that law corrected. So it's kind of amazing. 9/11 Truth being at the Second Circuit Court of Appeals right now is paving way for us to clarify just what it means by the First Amendment right to petition the government for a redress of grievances. It's really a fight for our First Amendment within the 9/11 Truth lawsuit. So it's so much bigger than 9/11 now. It's our First Amendment right. Like this is so fundamental. And you can't just explain that to somebody in a 30-second blurb or a meme on Facebook. It's really powerful what's happening right now.
And basically,
Go ahead.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Sandra.
Well, because I was just trying to explain that Supreme Court thing. Like what Mick had explained to us was that this Supreme Court error was already predating all of this. Basically, that there was a bad decision made where the Supreme Court, evidence, yes, needed to be presented, but there was no answer required on whether or not the evidence was going to be accepted to be looked at. And this is what they're trying to correct. They want
to essentially be ignored right now. And we just want to be able for them to either say no or go ahead.
Yeah, right, sorry. Like basically what this would change was that it might force their hand to actually, in future cases, give an answer as to whether or not the evidence in question has been, will be taken or not. And right now they don't even owe that answer. So So that's where that big impact would be if it went to the Supreme Court.
Mm-hmm. Ed?
I just put in the chat a link to a YouTube video I just watched last night by Dr. Edwin Vieira, who did a whole talk on judicial supremacy versus judicial review. Some of you may know who Dr. Edwin Vieira is, but he's a mentor of mine. He's a Harvard constitutional scholar, argued 4 cases for the United States Supreme Court, won them all, argued or briefed, I should say. And but he's one of the greatest legal minds on the planet, in my view. But he did a whole talk on judicial supremacy versus judicial review, which discusses the fallacy of the Supreme Court, or actually Congress and administrators and other courts, holding that whatever the Supreme Court says is what they have to follow, which is not a correct view of judicial review. And he makes a really, really good argument about it and talks about it in great detail. So I highly recommend everybody watch that video, because it's very, very pointed to what we were discussing here today.
Excellent. Thank you, Ed. Sandra, you are copying the chat for us. Morgan, go ahead.
I will. I listened to the little brief thing where Mick Harrison talked to the court. It's specifically whether the court has to look at the petition and say, this is what it is, before they say, okay, we'll do a jury. That's what it is, right? It's that we have the right to petition and have them at least look at exactly what it is before they send it and to be looked at by a grand jury, right?
Well, basically, yeah, you kind of had it there. As I understand it, it is that the information should be handed to a grand jury, and the grand jury tells us either no, I guess no, it would have to be U.S. attorney saying no, we're not going to present it. So I think you are saying it more correctly. We'll have to check with the.
Well, the irony is that the whatever you're presenting, there's the presenting of, and then there's the actual reading of. And so if you present it, you have to read it to know what you're denying.
Yes.
So there's an irony involved in the whole situation.
Yeah, it's so absurd.
Somebody's got to read the thing to know whether or not it's warrants rejection or not.
What's happening right now is absurd. The government.
It is.
Play. It's ridiculous. But we'll take it, but we won't look at it. That's not what the First Amendment means. We want to petition the government for a redress of grievances. Doesn't mean, hey, we give you information, you never look at it. That's just, anyway, go ahead, Morgan, you had another one, and then Al.
Oh yeah, yeah. I mean, it's basically what, you know, whether the court can just say, here's a title, 9/11, you know, lawyers inquiry, I'm not gonna look at that. We have to at least glance at it
once
to understand. Yeah.
Thank you. Yep. Alfred?
I'm just wondering about the judges and I know Mick never wants to answer that question, but do we have any indication when they're going to decide, from the presentation that he made? Does anybody have any idea?
So Mick said that it could be next week, it could be next month, and it could be 2 years. They really have, they're not bound by any limit of time. But it seemed to be good. I mean, I don't know. I listened to it. If you guys didn't get a chance, Mick did, we'll get the link for that, for the follow-up for this for everybody. Christina Borgeson, who's also on the board for a lawyers committee, did an interview with Mick after we did, but what she did, which was so much better, is that she replayed the oral argument, and Mick gave a play-by-play of what happened. And it starts at about 10 minutes in that video. You got to watch it, because it is really good. He explains why he said certain things, why the government's attorney said certain things. It's just great. Mick's sense of humor is so dry and cutting. I love it.
Yeah, if you can put the link in the you put the link in the chat.
Yeah, I was gonna say the same thing. Thank you.
Let me see if I could find it.
And by the way, Vier talked about some remedies of what could happen if a judge refuses to, like for example, in our case with the right to petition, if and when a judge takes on a case, the Supreme Court, for example, they take on a case and they rule in a way that is contrary to the Constitution itself, that could be considered bad behavior with respect to the judge, because the judges take an oath to the Constitution itself. So the judges are bound by that oath. So if they make a decision that is contrary to the Constitution, then they could be held, they could be actually removed under the good behavior clause. Or an indictment could be brought against them under 18 U.S.C. 241, 242. He talked about that. So definitely some remedies there if the judges decide not to honor this First Amendment petition. And it makes a lot of sense, because what good is a justice to take an oath if they're the ones who get to define what it means to violate it?
Right.
It doesn't make any sense. Yeah. So he brings that point up, and it's very, 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 actually, it's a very good video. I highly recommend it.
Yeah. Can I, Gene, I don't know who, most people are muted, but there's this like kind of like gargling sound in the background. I don't know if you have something running that's creating audio, but it's really distracting.
Am I? One, I posted the link to the YouTube video. And two,
let me yours and mine are the only mics that are open right now, and I still hear it.
Oh. No, I'm not even joined on audio. Oh, it's probably my work phone or my phone, because if the internet drops again, I don't want to keep cutting out.
Okay.
Let me try to mute myself and tell me if that's.
Well, good. Yeah, well, don't. Oh. Yeah, it's gone. I guess that's what it was, yeah.
No, that's weird. Anyway.
I mean, it's okay. I mean, it's not so bad. While we were talking about the judges, I don't know if you felt like sharing your little search of one particular judge and what it turned up visually.
Let's try this. Screen two. You guys seeing screen two?
Yep.
All right. Let me go to my mail. And I send it to Mick. I send it to Mick. A lot of stuff happened. Mick. Nope.
Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Did you guys see when he posted it? Yeah, there you go.
Okay. I wanted to bring something up. It's a little fringy, but I found it interesting. I wanted to look up three judges you spoke with at the oral arguments. When I brought up Eunice Cheryl Lee, a resemblance jumped out at me very quickly. I ran it through a couple of facial similarity apps, and they came up 62% familiar, similar, and 75% similar. And it was Spike Lee and this Judge Lee. just like, not just the glasses, but the nose and the mouth and everything. And then I wanted, just playing with it, I went a little further. Shelton Jackson Spike Lee was born in 57. He had brothers and sisters, Chris Lee in 58, David Lee, 61, Joey in 62, Sneak, or I don't know how you pronounce that, the guy, 66. And then Cheryl Lee was born in 70. So it's entirely plausible that could be the youngest sister. Spike's mother, Jacqueline Carol Lee, died in 1977. So that was 7 years before this lady was born, or after this lady was born. So just, that would be horrible, because if Spike was behind Spike in the story of New York Epicenters 2021 and a half, and she's one of the sitting judges in the Second Circuit Court of Appeals. But that's just fringy fun. I'm not into all that.
Total speculation, but the resemblance is uncanny.
Throw that in the heap of like numerology and all that stuff. but it's interesting. Something else I guess I should mention. Let me stop sharing. I have talked to Mick. I have a FOIA request for 100 videos within 1 mile of the Pentagon between 9:30 and 10:30 a.m. And it turned up 100 unreviewed videos on top of Scott Bingham's FOIA request back in 2004 to 2006, where that turned up the 85 videos and got like the Sheraton video that some of you may have seen and the famous five frames that we saw. So there's an additional 100 unreviewed videos. So that means it was never presented to the Congress or 9/11 Commission. And we're going to move forward with that. And I'm going to get him under retainer. And we'll see if we can get that those files. If not, we're going to go with the lawsuit. But hopefully it won't have to go to lawsuit. But I'm...
What are they saying as far as denying it?
They said that they can't get the time stamps on everything, or they don't have the time to figure out the exact distance on what's within 1 mile of the radius of the Pentagon. So they're, he said it's kind of interesting because normally they'd say you're not specific enough, and now you've been too specific.
right.
It provides an interesting angle.
Well, they got off on a technicality. Because they are telling him, it's like, oh, you want this specific time frame? Well, we don't have the time stamps. But yes, we have videos, but we don't know if they fit into that time stamp. Therefore, you can't have them. But in doing that, they admitted that they had unreviewed videos.
So we can
regardless of time stamps. So now Mick is saying, well, just, you know, rework it, resend it, remove the time stamps. You have the proof now that they say we have them. And just
I would simply say, give us 100 videos.
Yeah, that's what it's going to be.
You now identified 100 videos. We want those.
Yep. And I'm hoping maybe we'll get we call them Mac machines, a money machine with a camera that was aimed at the sky and could catch one couple glimpses of a plane coming in or something, just so that we could get clarity. And I still get people fighting against me. A conversation I had another night with another great gentleman, I just won't mention because I'm like, but he was like, why do you need that? You don't need that. Like, what would that do? And I'm like, it would confirm corroboration. Like, it wouldn't hurt. So, if I'm willing to fuck up the money for it, who cares? So that's going to be one of the avenues. Also the other avenue, and this kind of tails onto what you did, Ed, Mick, according to Mick, there's never been a state level grand jury for 9/11. And where Mick happens to be a Pennsylvanian lawyer, and I happen to be in Pennsylvania. So we're going to start the process for a state level grand jury in Pennsylvania. And I've got some other angles that I forgot to email that I'm going to add to that. Bob McElvain is in Orland, PA, on the other side by Philadelphia. So Bob McElvain could play a part in that, as well as, I don't know if anybody's seen Cyril Weck's been getting involved in looking at Bob McElvain's son's Bobby's autopsy report. That was actually done through legwork I did years ago, trying to get Cyril to look at this. And AE kind of finally, they were the one that actually got him to bite on it. But so now I know I'm going to reach out to Ben Weck, his son, and try to get Cyril Weck, the internationally known forensic pathologist, to try to work with this in the a grand jury investigation at a state level for Pennsylvania. So I'm really excited. It kind of hurts because I was dead set at 49. I was going to finally get my Honda Rebel motorcycle that I've been saving up for. And I got
a Yamaha Bolt.
Oh, yeah. I would rather have this shot at 9/11 truth. So I'm going to probably not be able to get my bike now for a couple more years, but I think this
I've had it for 8 years. I turned 85,000 miles on that bike.
Gotta love it. So 9/11 awesome. Truth instead of motorcycles. Who knows? But the Mick.
Well, you gotta have both because you need a motorcycle to get yourself reset your mind from the 9/11 truth.
Seriously.
And, yeah, you need the therapy.
Mick says what's great about this is if we put the money in that if we win the case, it would come back. We may get reimbursed for lawyers' fees. And I'm like, great. Then we can roll it into something else. And he laughed and said, sure, we could do that. So let's just let's keep paying it forward. So let's get justice for 9/11. So I'm really, really excited about that.
And I'd just like to go back to, I don't know how many of you were on the call last week, but Mick, and we're still waiting to hear back from Mick to give us the recap, but he came on asking us for help because they have these new avenues of, they were granted 10 interrogatories, 10 requests for documents, and 2 something else, anyways, with subpoena power. And so what he wants us to do is to, I mean, and I will send the email as soon as he can fine tune it in a way that everybody can understand it, what exactly it is he's looking for. But he wants us to look at the FEMA and the NIST reports, the documents that we're handing over, how they work, what requires them to keep documents, backup documents, under what conditions they can destroy them, what do they send to the National Archives, who the contractors were, what their names were, what their roles were. So basically that's my recap that I sent to Mick to kind of just like speed up the process so that he could just edit what I wrote from what he said. And then he would basically want as many eyes as possible on these documents and, you know, see, do they refer to documents that are then not there? We, you know, if we can prove the inadequacy of the reports that they put out, then they might be forced to work on a new report with the things that are missing. So even though the lawyers committee was given 3,800 pages, you know, they submitted 490,000 to the National Archives. So clearly not everything was there, like just a fraction of it. And so anybody who has detective eyes, anybody who can connect dots, you know, and see, hey, they mentioned this here, but then it never appears there. Like if they're referring to the pictures by Jonathan Barnett, well, if those pictures are not in the document, then we want to see those pictures. And they might show, you know, some of the evidence of the steel in the aftermath, you know, residue and whatnot. So, yeah, so Gene, go ahead, because you put that all in the War Room folder.
So what when we get the clarity from Mick on exactly what he wants us to do from Sandra's email, I made this easy for everyone. If you ever went to just 9/11 War Room, I know it's not a pretty website because I'm actually a website designer and I just want this for function. So it's just folders. It's a directory structure. And if you went under, I have the stickers and everything you guys can get in here. If you go under docs, FEMA 403 is what he wants us to look at. And it's all in here. The table of contents and cover, the executive summary, all 8 chapters and appendixes A through H. So this has everything in it. And like chapter 5, I believe, is World Trade Center 7. So here's the entire, let's see how many pages, 32 pages on the World Trade Center 7 part. And again, what he's not looking for evidence per se, but he's looking at where this information may be, how these organizations, what they did with their information, how they destroy their information. One other thing, let me share this with you. Let me go back. What I found, hopefully this won't crash. If you're like me, and I'll start to nod off reading. I would love to have an automatic reader. This is awesome. I have a link in here under docs, text to speech. Go to the online reader and you'll log in. And then what you do is you can drag and drop that file, which I already have done that. You download, so let's go back, FEMA 403. You would right click on chapter 1, save it to your desktop. Let me just do that so you guys can see this. Save link as to my desktop, FEMA 403 chapter 1. And I go back to this text to speech. Oh, hang on, I gotta stop my share because I didn't share sound. Oh, you'll hear it. Yeah, let me try this. Hang on a second, technical difficulties. Join the audio there, close this, hopefully I won't crash.
My laptop, I'm lucky my laptop has text speech automatically.
Oh, wow.
Five different voices you can choose. You just right-click. If I right-click, it won't do emails, but it does just about everything else.
Really?
Yeah, it's great. That's newspaper funny. Articles, things like that.
Yeah, that's...
Feeling dizzy yet?
PDF that people send me, I can
test. Do you see us right side up?
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
Here, just to show you, if Deb has another one, great one, that's cool too. But if you then go to your desktop and in here, FEMA 403, where'd FEMA 403 go? I said desktop.
Mm-hmm.
I can't refresh. View. Oh, come on, where's refresh? 7 desktop FEMA F, come on. Why can't nothing's in order? Hang on a second. Name.
Oh, by the way, I just put another link in the chat. It's one of the petitions for redresses that we filed that was related to the Supreme Court ruling, or not Supreme Court ruling, but the
one introduction
appellate court ruling.
Oh, so you know. Thank you.
If you ever want to draft one, that's a great example how to draft one, just FYI.
All right. So here is, so then when I drag and drop it into here.
One introduction. 1.1 purpose and scope of study. The events in New York City on September 11, 2001, were among the worst building disasters and loss of life from any single building event.
I mean, so you could just have it read it to you. They do, if you want to pay money, you can get like specialty voices that it's like me reading to you.
The events in New York City on September 11, 2001, were among the worst building disasters and loss of
That's
life from
amazing.
Any single building event in the United States. A total of 2,830 people lost due to the unprecedented...
So, that's available for everybody if you want, but Mick would like us to review these documents. Also...
There's a small fish in the big pond.
One other thing, in the FEMA 403, basically, as I understand it, if anybody knows better, please correct me, but FEMA got a lot of information and then George Bush signed into law on October 1st, 2002, the Safety Team Act report that needed to be done. And he got a group of people together at NIST, which I think was the fix. He got the fix in at NIST and got this group and they did the NCSTAR, the National Construction Safety Team Act report. That's what the NCSTAR files are. So in this FEMA, so FEMA gave all their information to NIST, and NIST then processed all the information. And NIST, this is their repository. I love this. It's literally terabytes of information. Like, I think this was 600 gig, just their fire tests and analysis. If you click on this, it goes through, and then you can see their photos and videos that they did for their furnace. You see all the studies are here. So I'm digging through that. Whoops, too far back. So literally terabytes of information. I want to start to download this. I got to buy more drives. And then right below it's all the NCSTAR, NIST, National Construction Safety Team Act report. And that's where we get our all the bull crap and lies and omissions.
So this is something that Mick wants us to look at as well, right?
So basically everything but FEMA gave to NIST and how NIST handled the information.
Right.
Where is this info? Where are there any loose ends? So what I did, some of you guys I may have emailed, I thought I found a little nugget on page one of that. Let me go back. Chapter one, page one. It says right here. Let me zoom in. He was asking in Sandra's email. Let me see. Sandra's email. He was asking, find out the names of the contractors involved in the building performance study who collected data and what their rules were. So this isn't exactly that, but I thought, where did it go? The study was sponsored by the Federal Emergency Management Agency, FEMA, and the Structural Engineering Institute of the American Society of Civil Engineers. So these were the two main heads. In conducting the study, the building performance study team received a tremendous cooperation from, and so my question is, if they received tremendous cooperation, was it in the form of documents, product, services? What was it? What exactly was it? Is it logged somewhere?
Financial.
So you got like City of New York, you got the OEM, all these groups, American Concrete Institute, the American Institute of Steel. Like, so what was their part in playing in that? And do they have information? And what did they do with it?
Yeah, they don't define cooperation. That's the problem.
Yeah, but that they had to use that adjective, though. Tremendous cooperation. Not just cooperation, but tremendous cooperation. I don't know if they were just trying to thank them, but if it was anything above and beyond, they should have some files or things sitting somewhere.
Right.
So that's the kind of detective work he wants. And I don't know, because I'm just a dumb carpenter. Go ahead, Morgan.
I was just thinking that this is kind of the perfect thing for at least the hopes of an organization like the Truth Action Project to, or anywhere else really, to present a sort of indeed.com, the job resume employer thingamajiggy. You know, what if we had a sort of board for that, for 9/11 truth or truth and stuff like that? I mean, this is advertising the idea, which is really great, because you're talking about new court cases that you're, I mean, honestly, this sounds very compelling to anyone that's a researcher that's looking for something to do. It'd be great to put this up somewhere, or to get websites like, you know, if not TAP, then SF 9/11 Truth, or all the other ones of those that they can put a link to this. If you could create, in addition, somehow to connect to this idea. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's it.
Definitely. As soon as I can get more information out and how we can get help.
You would think that Richard, I mean, you know, since he's working with the lawyers committee, might want to put something like that up on his own website.
Mm-hmm.
Once we have the specific guidelines, right, where he can, you know, especially now that he's building the community hub, it gives him a chance to reach out to people, anybody who feels capable of taking this on, because it's not for everyone either. I mean,
right,
you know, you're talking about very technical things. You're talking about specialized information that we're not necessarily equipped to process properly. So.
Right. I don't know if I had anything else.
So basically, you're talking about auditing the NC Star reports.
But not for, as I understand it, and I'm kind of confused on it because I'm not really good at this. He's not looking for evidence, but
inconsistencies.
Yeah. And that's going to be hard for me because, yeah. I'm not into reading volumes.
He's looking into anything that makes you say, hey, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Essentially is what, and the information on the contractors and their names and what their roles were and how they keep and destroy logs. Yeah. That should not be that complicated to find out. Right. There's got to be somewhere where NIST and FEMA specify, I mean, they have to be held accountable for the records, right? So somewhere in some kind of public sphere, there has to be some information about what they do with their records. I mean, it can't just.
Well, that would be a FOIA request. And what you do, you put a FOIA request in for those documents, any documents that came from those institutions.
So that's what we're doing. This is the legwork for David Cole's FOIA request. This is our break. This is our huge break that we haven't had forever. We got, what did we say? 10 interrogatories. This is all part of that. So this is the 9/11 truth movement. You guys being here, this 9/11 war room, I don't care what differences, I don't care about the egos. This is where we need to come. If we're a 9/11 truth movement, this is it. If we have some eyes on this, like, I know people are against the QAnon stuff, like those QAnons, they call them the people that are doing all the research and trying to put the pieces together. That's what we need right now, is a bunch of grunts just looking at it, pouring over this. And if they see something that makes it go, we need to start talking about it. And you, Ed, you and Adam jumped out immediately. You guys are, I suggested, he said, well, I would want to talk to whomever you suggest separately, or your little group. I consider you part of my little group. Which, by the way, this isn't the Gene LaRotonda show again. Adam called it the Gene LaRotonda show. This is not, I'm just trying to moderate it so it doesn't get out of hand.
He did correct that though. I just
oh, did he? All right, thanks.
Yeah,
I love him. I mean, you guys, as far as researchers, even Nelson Martin's, if you guys dug in on this, oh man. But whatever.
Well, that's the thing. It's like they actually are. They're just looking at it an easier angle, a more, because like for example, like we have George Tenet dead to rights on perjury, but nobody's pursuing.
Well, yeah, if somebody wanted to talk to Mick about doing their own legal litigation, they should pursue that.
I mean, yeah, even welcomed it. He said, you know, the lawyers committee is not like the epicenter of the legal angle, right? You know. He's like, the more things we have going, the better it is. And
but if we can focus on this one task that he's given us, he's going to give us a task list. I mean, that's why I just, you guys, your mentality, how you guys dig in on things from your own, how you guys do things. If you guys were looking at this task list that Mick gave, oh man, that would be invaluable.
Well, what they're doing is they're doing with the 9/11 commission report what we're currently being asked to do with respect to the NC Star report. So that commission report is where you're going to get a lot of the geopolitical aspects of it. And then also to the FBI field officer reports, things like that. And then, but the NC Star report deals with is going to deal with the investigation of the tower specifically, and the structure and the steel and things like that. So there's these two different worlds with reports that are associated with them. And it's like, which one do we put our energy into? We put our energy in both, but I would say both, because there's certain things that are gonna be easy to find with each one, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's kind of a, and that's where the challenge really lies, I think, is figuring out where do you put your energy, and making sure that everything is done in the most efficient manner possible.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
With the most impact.
Right.
What's going to be most impactful?
Well,
you know.
Also the timing. This one's like ripe for the pickings. Like, it's right there. We just got the okay from the judges to say, okay, you guys have discovery.
Yeah.
So
the problem with this one is that it's extreme. We're extremely time constrained.
Yeah.
We don't have a big window. I mean, already a week ago, Mick was speaking of barely having like a couple of weeks. And now that I kind of like got antsy, that's why I sent him that email about running out of time. He replied to me by saying, let me worry about the time. So I guess maybe he has more time than he thought, but it's still very tight.
Did he specify what he needs specifically?
That's what we're working on.
Is there something
he's
looking for exactly, you know?
That
so we can hone in on it.
But he's gonna fine tune it.
Mick's going to fine tune it, but this is basically it. Let me reread it again. Mick is asking us to look for the following. One, research the web and become familiar with how FEMA and NIST log records, what they send to the National Archives, and the LC was given 3,800 pages of the records, but 490,000 were sent to the National Archives. How do they destroy their records, and what requires them to do those things? Two, read the building performance study itself and see if there are any records that of what the LC might be searching for. So I showed you, I created a link. If you went to 9/11 War Room under Docs, you'll see FEMA 403, and that is the building performance study. And three.
So out of the 3,800 pages of records that they have, how do we know what they're what's missing?
I know. I don't know. I got. That'd be great for Mick if he was here, and he's not.
If you scroll up higher up in that email, the there's mention of some of the stuff.
Lawyers committee's order from magistrate judge allowing for limited discovery of David Cole's FOIA request regarding the building performance study by NIST and FEMA. Oh no, the building performance study by FEMA.
Okay.
They gave a lot of their information to NIST and now says they gave them all their information and nobody knows where the information is. He has been granted 20 interrogatory.
I think it's 10. I think that's a typo. It's supposed to be 10. Yeah.
No, that's 20.
Okay.
Yeah, because I remember writing that
down. I like
down.
How he spells Pina.
Sub Poena. Oh, nice. No, that was.
Oh my God.
It's a hard word. It's a hard word. I'm not going to lie.
No, you know what? I even know that. I don't even know why the hell I spelled it like that. I was so burnt when I wrote that email.
So 20 interrogatories, like 20 questions. That's why I remembered it was 20, because as soon as he said it to me, I remember 20 questions. 10 document requisitions with the power of subpoena.
That's so bad.
And two depositions. Basically, we get witnesses under oath to answer what's and get it transcribed. That's amazing. That's freaking amazing. That's awesome. Morgan, what do you got?
Hey, I sort of just a little tiny update to what I said earlier about advertising this as a cool job for truthy people. TAP can, if you've got a sort of actionable statement link done to take in new people wanting to do something, TAP can instantly, and I'm pretty sure I would definitely support it as long as TAP gives a quick okay, which is supposed to be doable in a week or less. We could get it this idea as an advertisement out on our social media.
Cool.
That's it.
Yeah. Thank you. Anybody, anything else? I'm all scattered because not having internet, I kind of broke everything up.
Right. I would ask them. We didn't ask anybody at the beginning if they had anything they wanted to discuss, so we might want to address that. I just wanted to quickly go back to, the action item that we've been focusing on until the end of February, and we're getting there, was, the idea of, spreading, making 9/11 truth visible by putting up stickers and flyers and banners and giving out business cards. And I was really hoping that more people would come on board to share pictures of what they've done. I wanted that to be an encouragement to others to start doing things themselves if they saw other people running with it. But for the next month, for the month of March, what I was suggesting, and this is totally up for discussion, would be to focus on reaching out to those people who have a public voice and may be receptive bringing 9/11 back to the forefront. And we're talking about people who, where we already know that Spike Lee was obviously open to it and then it just went south, but that doesn't mean that he's forgotten about it. And there's William Hurt, who has been, public about it. And Woody Harrelson has been very open about it in the past as well. So there are some people who have a big voice. Joe Rogan obviously is very high up on that list.
Eminem.
Eminem? I've never heard Eminem come out about 9/11.
So there's a website, or at least there used to be, I have a link to it, where they basically cataloged all the people in the world of note in different categories: actor, entertainer, scientist, you know, hot dog seller. And they had an extensive list, and I might have even taken pictures of the website because I was afraid it was going to come down. But yeah, Eminem. At some point, he said something at least as much as, you know, what some other people have said. You know, I want an investigation.
Okay.
Anyway, long story.
Does that website still exist, or?
I will try to find it. But it might be findable under, basically looking for celebrities or.
Right.
Signature.
Okay, well, we can definitely.
It was outside AE, I can tell you that.
There used to be a website that was art, actors and artists for 9/11 Truth. It was AA 9/11 Truth. And that one recently actually came down because it was inactive, but they had a lot of, you know, that's it, actors and artists, nothing outside of that. And the thing would be not to target everybody and anybody, but if we could single out half a dozen people, and if we made their email, the contact information available, you know, to get some well-spoken people who can actually put together a letter or a message, to try to reach these people, you know, just speak towards their, the importance of the platform that they have to address things that are critical, since they obviously have done so in the past and they're open to it, you know, they put it on the back burner and then they just move on. So maybe they need to be reminded that it still needs to be addressed. If we could do that, I think that this would be, it's a chance. It's a long shot, but it's a chance. And if they get, and here's my, this is my guerrilla activism part of it, is that don't do it by email, don't do it by social media, you do it by freaking snail mail, because nobody sends letters anymore. Nobody gets letters. Trust me, if there's an agency, the one that represents, you know, Spike or Joe Rogan or whatever, and they get bombarded with 1,000 emails a day, and suddenly there's an actual letter that comes that they have to open, you know, and that's typewritten and that they have to unfold, that's going to stand out. That's going to get their attention, especially if you, you know, add maybe some flyers or whatever in there. So that would be my suggestion for what we do in March. If we can get the addresses for these people, and we could get behind trying to contact them and appeal to their conscience, as basic as that.
Mm-hmm. So what I was, before I get to you, Al, what I was sharing is obviously write your, I know it feels like you're pissing in the wind, but write your representative, your senators. I looked up the most influential streamers right now and it popped up Joe Rogan. So I contacted Joe Rogan via his contact form and put a link on my 7 Kaboom, because I'm on my 11:30 day being on Facebook. But Joe Rogan, there was also Sean Hannity, there's Glenn Beck. I couldn't get Howard Stern's email address, even though he's probably a schmuck. Who else? There was what's his name? Somebody else I can't remember.
Well, Tucker Carlson, right?
Tucker Carlson. I couldn't get his email. Oh wait.
That well, you kind of figured it out, yeah.
So somebody mentioned that Sean Hannity's email address is Hannity@foxnews.com. So I didn't get a bounce back. So I'm like, well, Carlson@Fox News, and sent him the same letter, and I didn't get a bounce back. So I think he got it, or his staff got it. But
right.
Just, I mean, at least check out some contact forms online and send them something about where we are with the if you need help wording it, where the
oral. You know what? I can write the letters and we can put them up, make them available in the war room.
Perfect.
You can just.
And then just copy and paste them in, or copy and write them like Sandra was saying, send it snail mail. However you want to do it, just, yeah, we could focus on something. For the last month or two, we've been doing stickers. So continue on doing stickers if you're doing stickers.
But yeah, obviously, yeah.
We'll focus on letter writing and. it's just great to have like a grassroots group of people being able to do this stuff. And it goes in waves. I think it's just cool.
Yeah. Al's had his hand up for a while.
Go ahead, Al. Sorry.
Yeah, you already mentioned it, but I had thought about Howard Stern. I don't know where he comes down on 9/11, but he does have a big following. I don't know if he still does, but
and he's got a big mouth too.
Oh, he does, definitely. Yeah, big mouth.
He was very comfy with the official narrative.
Yeah, right? No, I remember early on. I don't know if he's changed because whatever. Yeah, I did want to mention
the early 9/11. There was a lot of early racism in the early days of 9/11. The word owl, I don't want to say it because it's kind of
the J word.
Gene,
go ahead.
I wanted to mention that Richard Gage's I can't pronounce it, his latest event in Mexico. I don't know if
you
know.
Acapulco.
Yeah, right, whatever. did you anybody look at that? Or I think he wanted $150 to watch it or something. I don't know.
I did not watch it. I tried to follow up some of these follow-up interviews. I listened to, I think, 10 minutes of one and 15 minutes of another. And they're all heavily pandemic, which I'm interested in it, but that's not my main focus. As you also agree, that's not your main focus either. So they were good, what I did listen to, but it doesn't tickle my fancy like 9/11 Truth does. So, but I hope he got the word out and people were all friendly with him. So he seems
to have connected with a lot of people.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah.
And I got to hand it to him. He's connecting to a lot of people over this pandemic thing. So, you know, to each his own, however anybody wants to do it, yeah. Do it.
And he speaks to people in such a way that they're receptive to it. It's really a gift that I wish more people in the movement had.
Right. Thank you for that, Al. Anybody else?
Kale.
Kale?
Yeah, I have a 3D printer that I've been trying to think of ways to use. And my wife and I were thinking about doing a 2 millimeter thick building 7 type of deal. But I don't know. This printer does amazing things. And I was like, how can I use this for 9/11 Truth? Because we're building all these other little things, but I think we can come up with something.
Click. Man, can you
I want a 3D version of my smoking 7 gun. Basically, it's a gun in the shape of a 7. That'd be awesome.
Right.
Could you do it at the moment of impact? What
this thing can do. I want to have this thing print out some truth. And how do I do it?
Kale, can I ask? And maybe this is a really stupid question, but what material does it come out in? Is it?
Well, there's different kinds. We usually use a PLA, which is more like a natural, like cornstarch and different biodegradable materials.
Okay.
And then you can use other materials that are harder but more chemical based, and then there's filament that is bendable. Yeah, so but we use
a PLA. It's like feeling plasticky, right? Though
it's a filament, and it extrudes out of this hot end, kind of like a glue gun, but okay. More precise. Like we're building things down to like below a millimeter, like
wow,
the detail is insane. If you go on my personal page, I have a 3D printing album. You can see the potential of what it does. But some of these prints take like a day or two, but some can take like 20 minutes. So if I came up with something really quick, I could make like keychains, I could make a zipper tag, like 9/11 Truth, or I don't know. There's so many things I could come up with.
All right, everybody start thinking about it over the next
that opens up a lot of possibilities. I mean, you know, even I mean for that matter, maybe even like a pendant or like a keychain, like a neck, like a, you know, like not I want to call it a charm, but you know, if you made that little 7 smoking gun 7 that I can put on a chain, I would totally wear that. I mean
huh
yeah
right, it's well, more
plastic material than a metal.
No, who cares? Okay.
Yeah. But just to get
that. I love that shirt. Let me see that shirt. Sit up.
He's driving.
Man, I want
to be with you.
I want a copy of that. That's awesome.
Actually, you know what? It was the original was what? May the truth be with you. And then my wife, we have a
vinyl printer.
We also have a printer that does shirts.
Yeah, so me too. I love it.
Like color down and everything.
Yeah, that's very amazing. Cool.
Who was first, Ed or Morgan? Ed, go ahead.
I was just saying, as people, just remind everybody as you try to reach out to this, that person, the other, to try and get them on board. It reminds me of a saying. In the beginning, a patriot, a scarce man, feared, hated, and scorned. But when his cause succeeds, the timid join him. But then it costs nothing to be a patriot. So yeah. Remember, we got to get some successes, and then you'll get the people. Success begets people. So let's get some successes in the courts, and let's show the world that we're not some fringe elves to be afraid of.
What's really pathetic about that is that we're basically banking on the sheep mentality to get for people to get on board. I mean, it's ridiculous that we have to go that route.
Well, I think that's what the CIA, it's just a quick little, my two cents. I think the CIA never let go of MK Ultra. And with Project Mockingbird, they basically learned that they can program us as machines. We're just dumb animals. We're just programmable machines. And they programmed for the decades. And now they've got the gist of the masses on social media, on network television. And if you can just convince the masses, the idiots, the basic ideas, you can control. They'll put everybody else in line. And that's what we're trying to buck those people in line.
Speaking of MK Ultra, have you heard of Kathy O'Brien and Mark Phillips?
No.
Look them up. Yeah, she was a White House Pentagon level sex slave for 30 years.
Oh,
under MK Ultra.
The old video.
Yeah. Anyway, I know them very well. Well, Mark passed away, unfortunately, but I shot 11 hours of interviews with them at their home in Alabama. Stayed with them for about a week, week and a half on one occasion, or a week on one occasion, 3 days on another occasion. But they showed me all the documentation, everything. It was pretty wild.
Wow.
Really fascinating story there.
Yes, it is. Thank you for that. Morgan?
Yeah. Update number 3. I can also send out an email to our entire database at TAP. If you guys come up with just a paragraph, we can make it independent of TAP if you want. Say TAP is just, here's something cool. We're not, we don't endorse blah, 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 a little disclaimer at the bottom, but here you go. Here's a great idea. And we can send that out to 3,500 people. Yep.
No, it's definitely, I mean, what you're saying is right. I mean, you do have a database of a lot of people. And if we ever do need to reach out for any kind of initiative on something that requires a lot of hands and eyes and whatnot, we need to keep that in mind. Absolutely, that TAP is...
you build it as a bracelet on the platter like this, and then it builds up this way. I think it would come out nice.
I'm going to mute him for a sec.
Yeah. Morgan, are you part of 911public.org?
So 911public.org.
I need to mention something on that.
Yeah.
So Richard and I were going to run parallel. He was going to do a community hub, and I was just going to keep 911public.org, basically doing the same thing and just copying the database back and forth as a group, because it's just public database. So people have already said they don't care if their information is public, so I'm just going to had it in two spots, but I cannot for the life of me get these two databases to transfer information very friendly. So it's kind of, I'm going to talk with Richard. This is kind of not for the record, but I'm on live, so it doesn't matter. Basically, it was just going to be the same thing anyway. So I'm going to eventually ask everyone that's on 911 public to recreate their accounts in the community hub. And I will be the one basically babysitting that project for him And it's not going to be like AE where we put our hands around and this is our user list and we're not giving it to anybody. This is a public list. So everybody will have access to it. You can connect with anybody on it. I'm not going to be this guy that's like a gatekeeper there over the list, the coveted Richard Gage community hub list, which is just 9/11 public. It's just going to be a public list. We can all communicate with each other on whoever wants to be public. And it's easier to do it under him, because it's the name Richard Gage. And yeah, so that's that.
Are you scrapping public.org then?
No, it won't be scrapped. Basically, it's the same functionality. If you right now I'm hung up on one thing. For some reason, the private email address and private phone number are being listed publicly, and I can't figure out why it's doing it. But as soon as I get that fixed, it's basically the same exact thing, and I'll just have the 9/11 public redirect to that exact thing. So it'll be the exact same thing.
You're not going to give it up on the War Room,
huh?
Well, the War Room, right? That's still rolling forever.
Oh, the War Room, the War Room's a separate thing, but a public directory is a public directory, so it's just easier for maintenance if I maintained it in one location than trying to copy it back and forth between two separate servers. So yeah, it's the functionality will be there. He'll actually have a list. I'm working on doing the same functionality for groups. So people will be able to go in and register their groups and see it on a map on where the groups are.
And there's still good reason to keep them separate, because let's say, God forbid, something happens on Richard's site with it. You'll still have yours.
But wait, I was thinking. Well, maybe. Okay. I hear what you and Sean are saying now.
No, but that's what we were talking about yesterday. No,
what was Richard's? I'm sorry, Sandra, to interrupt. And what was Richard's?
Right now, it's still under construction. But if you went to richardgage911.org and scroll down on the side, you'll see Community Hub. And then when you click on that, you'll see three buttons. Let me just show you. Jeez, oh, man. Share my screen. Oh, wait. No, I have no internet. Oh, it's back. I'm not going through that again. Let me try it again. Maybe I will. Let's be hypocritical and do it. 911warroom.com/zoom. Join the call. Here I come. Share my screen. I will not join with audio. Screen 2. Let's go to Richard Gage. Richard Gage 911. And we scroll down on the side, and he has a thing called Community Hub. And that goes down to these three buttons. Advocates, and they look nice looking buttons, eh? I designed those. Anyway. 9/11 advocates and activists, action groups, and websites. He just wants to be like the repository for 9/11 stuff. And he's Richard Gage, so yeah, he's got a bigger name, and everyone's going to flock to him. So yeah, let's go with it. Advocates and activists. This is basically 911public.org. The problem is for me to manually switch over 150 people right now, I think it is, it's just going to kill me for time. So it's so much easier if I could just ask, I'll send a mass email out and say, can everybody recreate their account over here? But not right now, because here's the problem. Right now it lists. Oh, now it's not doing it. That's freaking funny. As AF, like I could swear right now, this is ridiculous. It's not showing the private stuff. Is it working now? Let me try this thing. Hang on a second. Log in, Gene Laritonda. They'll send me back to the homepage because I'm an admin. Go to Richard Gage. There's a community hub. Choose advocates and activists. Gene Laritonda. I want to edit my profile. This works. No, wait, private? Yeah, it's showing. So when you edit your profile, it's allowing you to see your private and public, but it won't let you see your private email address. That's the only thing that's broken right now. When you edit, you won't be able to edit your private email address, which is actually what falls behind the contact me tab. So people won't know your email address, as you guys know, and they could still contact us. So it's almost there. I almost got it. So don't put your information, because this may or may not show your private information you don't want shown. And I haven't fixed that yet, but I'm working on it. So there's that. Jeez. Thank you for letting me share that. If I get off, I can actually order my spaghetti dinner and actually get it tonight. So we're going to go around the room. Oh, Al, you're up. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to say Boston 9/11 Truth has its own mailing list. And I'd like to link it up with like TAP when you put out that advertisement for helping the lawyers committee. I need to get permission from some of the people, you know, whether they want to opt out of that or not. But we do have an extensive list. So just an FYI.
Thank you. Around the room, everybody, anything for the group? Speak now or for hold your peace for another week. All right. Great to see you all. Love yous. Have a great week.
Wait.
Wait, what?
Wait, I have to copy the chat.
All right. See you upside down, Deborah Lee. Keep hanging in there.
Maybe I'll have my feet on the ground next week.
Right. All right. I'm good.
All right. See you, everybody.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Upside down.